Obsidian 1.8 is available for insiders. If you're not one of them, here is what you can expect. Let's go. I will take you through the major changes in Obsidian 1.8. It comes with some really nice new features, many improvements, and a bunch of bug fixes. We are not going to look at each and every one of those, but I want to share the highlights with you. First up, a new core plugin entered the game. It's called Web Viewer. Here is what the changelog has to say. Web Viewer, a new core plugin, lets you open external links within Obsidian. This simplifies reading linked content without leaving the app and makes multitasking on web research projects easy. So let's go and see it in action. Now, this plugin is disabled by default and needs to be enabled manually in settings. So let's just go to Settings, Core Plugins, and enable the Web Viewer. Once this is done, we take a look at its settings. The first one lets us define whether we want to use the Web Viewer plugin to open links in Obsidian instead of our default browser. If disabled, we will have to right-click on links and choose to open them in the Web Viewer. When enabled, clicking a link will automatically open it within Obsidian. Next, we can define a home page to load when an empty viewer is opened. I leave this empty as I prefer to navigate directly to the content I need. We also get a list of search engines that we can use within the web viewer. You can choose your preferred one from here, making it even easier to research directly within Obsidian. The next three settings are related to something that many of us will appreciate: a built-in ad blocker. This is enabled by default, and unless we experience issues, we will probably want to keep it on. We can also modify or add blocking rules to fine-tune its behavior and ensure it effectively blocks any unwanted content. And then we can set the frequency for updating these filter lists. We can pick a value from 0 to 24 days, with 0 meaning that they will not be updated automatically at all. And lastly, we have the option to clear all web viewer data, including cookies and cache. I prepared a demo note here with some links to different websites. Clicking on a link opens the web viewer in a new tab and displays the content of the website directly within Obsidian, as we would expect. If we arrange the tabs side by side, it becomes clear how seamlessly and efficiently we can research information and transfer it to our node. Additionally, there are the options to switch to reading view or save the entire open web page to the vault. We do not yet have functionality that we find in the Obsidian Web Clipper, but perhaps this is still in the cards and will come a bit later. Who knows? The new command download attachments for current file downloads all externally embedded images and replaces the external links with internal embeds. This is a fantastic improvement for managing media within your nodes, making them more self-contained and accessible offline. Personally, I like it because it complements the Obsidian Web Clipper very nicely. Let me show you how easy it is now to get web content into Obsidian and then make it available offline. Let's start with this web page. We use the Obsidian Web Clipper to send content to Obsidian. The Clipper does a great job of grabbing the text and any images, converting them into a nicely formatted node within our vault based on the selected template. Back in Obsidian, we see the newly created node, and if we look at the images, we can see that these are still linked to external URLs. But now, thanks to the new command, we can download all attachments for this file. To do so, we open the command palette. By default, via Ctrl and P, select Download Attachments for Current File, and Obsidian will ask us to pick the images we want to download. In this case, I have only one, but if we had multiple, we could select and deselect them as we wish. After selecting the desired images, Obsidian will download them and replace the external links with internal embeds within the node itself. Now, all the media is stored directly in our vault, making it more self-contained, and of course, making sure we have the information and images available offline. By the way, you may have noticed that I assigned a hotkey to this command. This makes it, of course, even faster and more convenient to use. One of the many advantages of using Obsidian is that we can assign hotkeys to pretty much all the commands available. Did you know that not subscribed viewers create more than 80% of the overall watch time on this channel? If you ever enjoyed my videos, please, could you do me a favor and hit the subscribe button? It helps the channel more than you know. And the better it does, the more high-quality content I can create for you. Thank you. With version 1.8, we also get some quality of life improvements for working with properties. First, we can now easily sort a node's properties alphabetically. We just right-click on the properties header, select Sort, and the desired sort order. Second, if a property has multiple values, we can now copy individual ones using the context menu or the Ctrl C shortcut. We just have to select the respective value and then right click on it or use the hotkey. Perhaps these changes are not exactly earth-shaking, but I think they can come in quite handy. We also get a few improvements in the file explorer or file navigation. This is what they look like. First, we now get a context menu when clicking in the tree view. Frankly, I had not missed this so far, but I suppose some people did, and they will be happy now. The second change allows us to select multiple items. This can be notes, images, canvases, etc. Right-click on them and create a new folder with these items in it. This is certainly useful for maintaining a clean folder structure easily. The last file explorer related change I want to highlight is an improvement when moving files from one folder to another. It used to be that we had to open the destination folder and then move the files there. Now we can select a file or files, drag them over a collapsed folder, and that folder will expand after a movement so that we don't need to open a destination folder prior to moving the files anymore. I really like that one. In this chapter, I summarize several small-ish improvements from different categories. If you tend to have many tabs open at the same time, you will have run into the issue of seeing all the close buttons, but not much of the tab titles. This changes with version 1.8. Now, the close buttons of inactive tabs will be hidden unless we hover over them, leaving more room for the title and making it easier to find what we are looking for. Next, the context menu for callouts now does not only allow us to change the callout type, but also has an option to remove the callout formatting completely. Until now, I used the community plugin to do that. So this little improvement helps me to reduce the already quite long list of plugins I am loading into Obsidian. To demo the next one, I opened two nodes side by side. Both nodes have incoming links, so-called backlinks. Until now, we could configure the backlinks core plugin to show backlinks at the bottom of a node. However, this setting applies to all the nodes in our vault. In version 1.8, Obsidian introduces a new command called toggle backlinks in document. And this does exactly what we would expect. We can now activate the display of backlinks in individual nodes rather than for the whole vault. I'm very happy about that one. I find backlinks very useful for many of my nodes, but I really don't want to have them on all of them. This release also includes a whole list of bug fixes. You can find them all in the official changelog, the link to which is in the description for you. Here is this full list. I suggest going through it at your own pace and focusing on the issues that might directly impact your workflow or the features you use frequently. What we can say for sure is that the team, once again, did a great job addressing a lot of issues in this release. I hope this quick peek gives you a better idea of what's coming in Obsidian 1.8 and makes you looking forward to it. Also, if you want to get faster access to new versions and support the development team, maybe consider becoming a Catalyst member. I left a link to that in the description for you as well. Speaking of support, if you found this video helpful, perhaps drop a like, subscribe to the channel, and ring the notification bell to make sure you won't miss the next ones. It's easy to do for you and really helps me. And if you could share it with whoever might be interested, well, that would be great too. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. If you need help or have any questions, the YouTube comments might not be the easiest way to interact with each other. Alternatively, you can find me on your preferred social media platform. You can find the links to all my profiles in the description below. And that's it for today. Thanks for watching and see you next time.